Hello, everybody, and welcome to Battle Code 2010. I apologize for the delay, but we had to make sure everything was going smoothly and everything would work perfectly today. So let me just bring up the PowerPoint. Awesome. Okay, so welcome to the final tournament. The first thing I want to do is introduce the devs who have worked so hard for your enjoyment. First we have Dan Galata, all the way from Princeton. He worked on engine and instrumental code. Next we have Trevor. He came back from last year. He wasn't even supposed to be a dev, but he greatly helped us out. Next we have Andrew. Andrew worked on the client, making everything pretty. The new graphics that you'll see today. Next we have Joel. Joel is responsible. Yeah, Joel has been here a while. But yeah, he's responsible for making the website run smoothly and organizing a whole lot of this stuff. Next, we have Ben Frankel. He is new this year. He is responsible for making the tournament run smoothly. These are our sponsors. This year, our platinum sponsor is DRW, and we have lots of gold and silver and bronze sponsors this year. This will be the 8 teams that will be playing today. They are the finalists of the qualifying tournament. This is also their seeding rank. So we know that, for example, my Archon died Bellman forwarding the stream will be playing 8999 first based on seeding. Okay, so I want to explain for the people that don't know much about Battle Code how Battle Code works. So the first thing you might notice is it looks a lot like StarCraft, but it's not StarCraft. Yeah, there's a lot of units running around and shooting each other, but there's a big difference. See, each unit is actually running its own code, and there's no big distributed... There's no big system from the top down telling each robot what to do. Each robot decides what to do themselves. And the only way they can communicate is through messages or perhaps doing a silly little dance that some other robot might recognize, kind of like bees or something. So this year we have 5 distinct robot types. Archons are returning. Archons are the only unit to grow hit points every round, and every other unit loses hit points every round, unlike most other RTSs. You have to use your Archons to give hit points from them to the other units so that they can stay alive and be effective. Our other units are the Wout, which is a combination of Worker and Scout. It is a very fast unit, although it is a ground unit. Like Archons, they can build buildings. Of course, only Archons can still spawn units, and the other nice thing about Wouts is they can gather energon. I mean flux from terrain. Flux on terrain grows every single turn based on how high the terrain is. This year, we actually have buildings. Buildings are immobile, and they have no energon. Their life is completely based on the flux that is used to build them and the flux that is used to heal them. The 3 buildings are the comm tower, which can sense and broadcast very far away. Unlike other units, which have a very limited ability, this way you can organize your units much better. We have the teleporter, which allows you to not only teleport from any teleporter to any other teleporter, but also very valuable to sense other teleporters all across the map. So for example, if you know that you're not sensing a teleporter anymore, probably the enemy is there. We also have aura buildings, which can use flux to provide a benefit in a certain radius. For example, increasing attack power or adding defense or even making your units move faster. So this year, the goal is to create buildings and to gather points with the buildings. The way you actually gather points is you have to build buildings within a close proximity of each other, within a distance of 5. So every single chain of buildings or web, such that in this web, there are at least 2 buildings within 5 of each other, create a convex hull, and we figure out the biggest convex hull, and we award points every round based on the area of this hull. Once a player gets a certain amount of predefined points more than the other player, that player wins. And of course, like every year, you can also win by killing, which is very exciting. Okay, so this year we actually have more of a theme. You know that from last year's story, Lord Mordemort, which is the evil villain, was captured in a jail on some asteroid far away. But this year he has escaped and he is planning revenge and building a huge fortress. And we actually have a video of it to prove it. Hopefully. Whoa. So one last thing, in this video you saw a few units that I would like to explain quickly. So we have turrets right here, which is the strongest defensive unit. They can sacrifice their ability to move to become, to have a very strong and fast attack. The workers are right here, which I mentioned earlier. We have soldiers, which are returning from last year, which is basically a melee unit. But this year, they also have the special ability to slow down anybody they attack. The archons are returning as these airplane-like things over here. And the chainers, which have a ranged attack and deal splash damage, are drawn right here. You can also see a comm tower built over here. So now we can get on to the final tournament. And as always, I ask the 2 teams that are currently playing to speak about their player. And as I mentioned before, the first 2 teams will be Bellman Ford and 8999. If you can come up. And if you can.
Hey guys, we're Bellman Ford, and this is 8999. So hopefully we'll bring you another exciting match this year. So this year, the game is really developed into a meta game of 3 different strategies. The first is swarming, the second is splitting up and building a large hull, and the third is splitting up and fighting. And we see them really as a game of rock, paper, and scissors, with the rock being the swarming, the paper being the splitting up, and building, and the scissors being the splitting up and fighting. Now we're in red here, and both our teams seem to have thrown rock, and we seem to have done pretty well in the fight.
They have a much bigger rock, I'll have to say, because you might have noticed we both spawn fighting units and try to fight out in the middle. and I've lost this game. I think it was choice of my team name. I think their power level is over 9,000. So my chances of success are very slim right here. So we'll try it again.
One funny thing is Zvied, the 2 years he was in the top eight, he knocked out the winning team both times when he played them. So we're a little worried playing him. But the first game seems to have gone well. So our units are fighting, and the wall, the black void squares might give us a little trouble, but we've managed to concave and surround him and win the fight. So hopefully we can pick off two of his archons. Another advantage of this map is its size is pretty small, so we're able to cover a lot of distance quickly and not have to worry about him building up while we're caught unaware.
It's true. Their fighting is exceptionally good. Unfortunately, this year it didn't happen. What happened in previous years? Oh, good game.
Hey everybody, I'm Dan, Team Drunkasaurus.
And we're Board Boyd. Good luck, Dan.
Good luck to you guys too. So, my Archon strategy, they act a lot like I do, in that they basically just split up and do whatever they want. So, sometimes it works and sometimes it doesn't. What color am I?
You're
I think
blue.
I'm blue.
We open up very similar to Bellman Ford in that we stick together and we throw a rock, if you will, at the opponent. Dan actually has some really good micro, so even though he splits up his Archons, he does a really good job of keeping them alive.
Not a good enough job.
You'll see, you can keep track of the Archons on either side of the 2D client. We've been chasing him around and he's so far only lost one.
We also typically send one wout to build in the center because, after all, the main point is to win by points. In this way, if we don't succeed in killing all his units, we hopefully will have some slight point differential.
Yeah, my guys are kind of lazy, so they're not doing so well right now.
You can see on the 3D client at the very top, there's a bar that has a bit of red to one side of it. That's the domination bar. It basically just measures how many points you have more than your opponent, and if it gets too large, one side will win.
So the only consolation I have in this match is that I managed to destroy their hull for a while by attacking the corner of it. Oh, I just did it again. Awesome.
Dan, stop that.
Holy crap, I might win this one.
So we really hate it when people go towards the center, because when they go towards the center, they usually knock out our buildings, which is really annoying.
Oh, I was going to say, it's kind of strange, because usually I've noticed whenever I've seen them play before, they usually send out some guys to build in the corner, which seems to work really well for them. So I actually was kind of weirded out when I saw them change their strategy up like that.
We should be sending some guys to build in the corner shortly, but I don't think it'll be soon enough.
I don't think it's going to matter. I'm about to die.
No, you're going to win this one, Dan. You got it on points.
Woohoo. All right, if I die, at least I won the one. So this is a small map again, and I think they're going to have a very big advantage over here. Since my guys split up, they usually don't get enough, if they don't have a large map to run around on, they usually don't have a chance to really build anything before they get killed. With some of the other teams that don't have as good micro, it's not really that much of a problem, but Boyd's got really solid combat code, so I'm in trouble here, I think.
Small maps tend to favor the strategy of sticking together and chasing down the enemy, because even if you try to split up and build, the teams that stick together and chase you around have a better chance of actually being able to catch you before you outbuild them, which was what happened last time.
And you'll notice here that they're doing a pretty good job, because I haven't actually even had a chance to build a complete convex hull yet. All right, we don't have any sound effects, so I'm just going to go pew, pew, pew every once in a while. Ow.
So we told our Archons that after they kill some number of enemy Archons, they should split up and go build in the corner. And, oh good, they're actually doing it. I was afraid they weren't doing it. I was going to be very upset.
Yeah, and they build fast once they start.
We're pretty cool.
Stay alive, little guy.
Round three.
I still won that one. That's all that matters to me.
Ooh.
Oh.
So
this will be interesting.
This is a very big map, and we actually have two separate strategies. One of them is actually to detect that it's a big map, and when we detect that this is a big map, we're actually going to split up and build instead of trying to chase down the enemy.
Oh,
so at some
crap.
Point very shortly, our Archons are going to reach the other corner, and they're going to realize, oh, this is a big map, and we'll see how that actually works out for us.
Sometimes this ends up with us splitting up and then dying really fast. I'm really excited.
If they're excited, then I'm not. Oh, hey, I've got a tiny little hole going there.
Dan, could you tell your Archons to stop running, please? This is really annoying.
Could you tell yours to stop fighting? I just want peace.
So this is interesting, Steven. Our Archons are actually not splitting up and building right now. Do you know why this is?
Hey, look at that. Look at that. There's a hull in the center. I don't want to hear it, Eric Chen. Look, it's entirely possible that this map is not technically large by our arbitrary definition of large.
Apparently not, because you have almost covered it already.
But we do make a very nice kite.
Woo, I got one. Yeah, I think they're going to win on points very shortly.
We also refuse to split up, even if it's a large map, if we still see enemies, so we won't even do the split up unless we both know it's a large map and there are no enemies within like a close distance.
As you're going down, pass it. Two swimming submarines and black sheep.
Hey, we're Team Black Sheep.
We are in swimming submarines.
All right, so we've seen some rock teams before. We chose to go paper as our high-level strategy because we knew that we wouldn't be able to form a harder rock than other teams. So we decided to try to outsmart them that way. So in secret, we worked on our paper strategy starting about a week or two ago, and we didn't show anyone it, and we came up with a lot of cool ideas. And then at the last minute, we submitted it to the server.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, we saw that like, some of these rock strategies looked like a really great idea, but our rock was just getting crushed by some bigger, heavier, stronger rocks that were out there. So we thought, you know, we should make a really good paper strategy and just not tell anybody about it. Like, just gonna keep it completely secret. And so we didn't tell anybody, waited right down to the end and submitted it. And then we saw that these guys did the exact same thing.
Yeah, so we fought each other in the qualifying tournament, and we actually thought that they were a scissors team, so we switched into rock. And so that was a very quick match, because our bad rock against a paper. Hopefully here, we're both going to play paper.
Yeah, so ideally, you know, maybe you'll see some people building in corners, trying to build some holes.
No.
If anyone comes, we like to run away. And and try to teleport to a different corner. Looks like we're building a little bit if we're blue. Are we blue? No, we're red.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
We're not building. We are.
Looks like units are teleporting.
Looks like we decided the map was small, and we're gonna try to fight. Because on a small enough map, it's hard to teleport away.
Right. We do the exact same thing, except here they switched, and we didn't. So since both of our strategies are optimized against playing rock, switching to rock against each other is a very bad idea. Because, I mean, you know, who else is going to play paper in Battle Code? Just, you know, just the one team doing it in secret, right? Right, okay, so sorry. So what a paper strategy is we're going to build teleport towers in the different corners. Then when a swarm comes, we're going to teleport our Archons out. And we can teleport our Archons out actually pretty quickly before they can kill us. So this is why a paper strategy will beat just a straight rock strategy.
Looks like the map wasn't small enough for us here. Maybe we should have tried our paper instead of going with our swarm.
So this is pretty much the exact opposite thing that happened in the qualifying tournament, because in the qualifying tournament, their strategy was deploying rock because they thought the map was too small. And then they lost because we deployed paper. And on the other hand here, well, on the last map at least, it seems that we deployed rock, they deployed paper, and they just crushed us.
It looks like maybe the same thing is happening here.
Yeah, it looks like the map was big enough for them to build again, small enough for us to fight again. So we'll see what happens.
Oh, yeah, okay, so you can see them come over, and they're going to try to take this corner from us, and they're going to succeed, because we're just going to evacuate as quickly as we can. But since you can sense where all your allied teleporters are, we notice that a teleporter has disappeared. And we no longer kill our own teleporters, so that usually means that the enemy killed it instead. So given that, we teleport our fighting units in to try to counterattack. And so sometimes the counterattack works, but usually you'll just slow them down, and that's good enough for our Archons to teleport out, find a new corner, and then build that up. It also helps against simpler teams, like the team that just runs around the sides of the map that we used to not do very well against. It was embarrassing.
We're dragging this out a little bit. The map is small enough for us to get to some of these corners.
You can see us try to teleport some units in there. Not a whole lot, though. The problem is that teleporting in units slows down our building of the other corners, which is why it takes us a long time to get points on small maps.
Next up, you must construct additional pylons versus experiencing a significant gravitas shortfall.
And pylons?
Hi, we're team experiencing a significant gravitas shortfall.
Alright, so my strategy is kind of like an extreme spread out and build everywhere strategy.
Whereas our strategy is a more offensive strategy where our Archons try to stick together and wipe out the enemy team. So we'll see how these two teams will do.
So my Archons are programmed to run away every time they see the slightest hint of danger, so we'll see how this works. Also, the fighting units are also programmed to suicide themselves to buy the Archons more time to run away.
not that great for us, apparently.
So it looks like I'm building, am I blue? I'm blue. Okay. So it looks like I have a 73-point lead so far.
We're glad we have 1 point.
Oh.
So it seems like we just managed to get our first success at combat.
Oh, they got a lot of kills.
But there's still a lot of rounds to go, and anything can happen.
So hopefully I can run away for 2,600 more rounds, but I'm probably going to die.
So in the middle, we've decided we won the fight, and we've dropped one Archon to start building a convex hull. So he should remain that way for the rest. And it's over. So in the second match, we decided that our opponent did not throw a rock, and we changed to a pair of scissors, I guess. So all of our icons will split up and do whatever they want.
Yeah, my icons don't really check the size of the map, so they just do the same thing every time. So this could end up pretty bad for me. Although there are a lot of walls on this map, so it'll be hard for a ground army to chase down my archons.
So I think everyone's going to come up and talk about their strategy, but I thought I just wanted to say something on the funny side to entertain you while the match is going on. If you look on the left and the right side, well, the right side not so much now. okay, anyway, they kind of look like fruit flies if you think about it. And that's where I got my nick. He basically swat off the fruit flies. As you can tell, there are none on the other side now.
Oh. Good job.
Okay, now we have Bellman Ford and Boyd Boyd.
All right, so a bit of history between these two teams. We're actually really afraid of this team because they're the only team to beat us in 2 out of 3s on the Scrim server. And also, they beat us in a 3v4 match on StarCraft. So
there are two important things to keep in mind about that. We beat them twice on the Scrim server. They beat us about 15 times. And in the StarCraft game, I was replaced by somebody who was good at StarCraft.
Good luck, Bellman Ford.
Good luck.
Yeah, good luck. So we both sort of start the same way. The units that, so like, because we started at opposite sides, we run into each other really quickly. The units that we both spawn at the beginning are called chainers. Chainers are really good units for fighting because when they attack, they, oh, looks like we're red, right?
You're probably red, yeah.
You'll notice that they have really, really good attacking code.
So what I was going to say is the chainers is a really good unit because when they attack, they don't just attack the square that they attack, they also attack the surrounding squares. So you do extra damage that way. So when you're clustered like that, chainers are really good for that first battle.
So this may be a map where we have a chance, because there are lots of long walls we can retreat across, and those tend to be the maps where we can actually get wins off against Bellman Fort.
So yeah. What can happen in these kind of maps is we'll very, very slowly build something in the center, so we hopefully run away as fast as we can. So we'll see.
What often happened on the scrim server is we would chase them the entire time, all the way around the map. So something you'll notice that our archons do during battle is they try to maintain a distance from the enemy, and when they reach the optimal, like a nice distance from the enemy, they spread out. And what that allows us to do is avoid the enemy's chainers attacking a lot of our units. And it also allows our units to focus our fire into the center of our what we call a concave.
This is a nice long stretch right here, so we might be able to get something, especially if we get them in the corner. Looks like we just got three of their arc. Four, five, six. There we go.
Good game.
Now for Black Sheep and experiencing a significant gravitas shortfall.
Theirs is the perfect strategy against ours, so wish ourselves good luck.
So this is a pretty large map. You'll notice that our team tries to split up and take three corners, or possibly four, I can't remember if Kmod changed it, four, as fast as possible. You'll notice we try to also build up a teleporter as fast as possible, since it's pretty crucial to our strategy, because it's our sort of only escape route. Kevin actually added some pretty cool code where it's this last ditch effort when he goes all Hail Mary and tries to send out wouts and build up towers in case we do get sandwiched, but it looks like that's not going to happen here.
So our first strategy is we keep our units all together and we try to push our enemy to a corner, but this is not really working well. But thankfully we have one other unit that will try to build in the center if we can.
So here they're attacking our thing. You should see us teleport a lot of chainers in, see them fade in and kind of just get sent to their death. But you'll also notice though that when they teleport away, they'll actually try to, if they see there's too many archons in the corner, they'll actually move to another corner and try to build that up as fast as possible. So we kind of expect that after they finish killing us, that spot kind of gets left open, so it's going to be a safe haven. You'll see that our units right now are going to that top left corner.
Our main offensive team actually roams the map. We have a couple of waypoints at various points of the map, one at each corner, one at each middle of each edge, and one in the center. So we will try to make sure that we visit each waypoint every few rounds.
So one thing we're not very good at is taking out their hulls. That we got kind of lucky there that we just sent some units through the center. But basically, we are just as afraid of them as possible. So if they build up a nice big hull in the center, then that's bad news for us. So building a hull like that is pretty good for us, except for the fact that so when that happens, actually, our archons get really confused. So like they can't find an actual building spot after that happens, and they just stay in one place and don't do anything. So it's actually good that they killed it, because then our archons unfreeze again. Actually, it's probably not good. But
One thing you'll notice about when we teleport units in is that sometimes they run the wrong way. Archons and wouts have the greatest sight range, but the soldiers have significantly less sight range. So sometimes when they teleport in, they don't see the enemy, and they'll try and return to one of the corners.
So if you look at the domination bar on the top of the 3D map, you can see we're pretty close to losing. Now it's blinking as well, so I think time is running low.
Yeah, so we got lucky there again, and one soldier randomly decided to run through the middle and was able to take out a tower. But we're losing our advantage pretty quickly here.
So like in the previous match, if we detected that we did not lose all our archons, we would actually switch to a different strategy where we just split up our archons and they will all act independently. Some of them might build, some of them might fight.
And this map is a lot shorter than the last one was, so they're able to cover a lot more ground before we're able to get hulls up. But then the center where they'll be building their hull is also a lot smaller too.
So hopefully some of our archons will actually be able to leave combat and start building something.
We haven't actually played against a scissors team before, so this will also be pretty interesting too. This plays out.
So in at the bottom, one of our archons is just moving away from the main group, and he's going to disturb the hull at the bottom.
Now it's 8999 versus Drunkasaurus. Yes, the battle of the one-man teams.
Okay, so I'm guessing I'm blue, based on the fact that they're actually all in a swarm. Hey, I'm already building awesome.
Actually, everyone who is fighting usually uses chainers to fight, except for his team. And on the scrimmage tournament, he actually managed to kill my archons too, so I'm really worried about this match. They're very good at fighting with those soldiers. They just come at you and attack you, and you don't know what to do because you're just used to these chainers that attack you from distance. My guys get very confused. So,
finally, an advantage to being stubborn. And it looks like he took out my hull there, but I've got another really, really ridiculously small one going up in the west side.
My strategy is to, while I'm going around killing enemies, to build a little hull behind me. Like with that little guy over there, he's trying to build a little thing down there to gain some points. Right now he's not doing so well, but maybe he will build something.
Oh, he's got two of my guys now. So the reason he might not be doing so well is because I actually implemented something for the seeding tournament. I noticed that whenever my team split up in previous tournaments and was able to actually surround the other team, then it did a really good job of beating that team because they have a hard time fighting battles from all sides, the other team. So I wrote code that would flank the other team on purpose this year. And they'll just try and circle around and surround the other team. But it looks like I've lost their... they've killed the guys that were flanking. So now it's just who can build the best.
My guys are just very confused right now, and they don't know to go to the other corner. As if only they would just go to the other corner, everything would be great. They're just too confused. I don't know why, actually. I really don't know. Usually they just go around the circles and just... do their thing, but this time around, I think I'm gonna... Their domination bar is dominating too much.
Okay. Yeah, one big difference for me between me and the other build teams is that I actually try and pump some extra flux into my towers after I build them to make sure that a passing wout or a soldier can't knock them over in one or two shots. So that means that if my players, since they split up a lot, if they happen to come across another hull, I can take it down pretty quick, but the same can't really be said about mine. However, if a big team, like a swarm, comes up to mind, then it's just a waste of flux because they're going to knock it down either way. There's no way I can defend it.
Now, there is one problem with this map. Even though it's a little smaller, I think, than the last one, there are a lot of walls, and my navigation is not as good as it should be, probably. So units kind of get stuck in the middle, as you might have noticed, and they die off.
Oh, wait, for sure. I could hear that.
You're right there.
Share with the rest of us.
No, you got to bring your own. So it looks like I'm not really able to keep any hulls up because they're able to explore the map fast enough to find them as soon as they come up, but I still have a very small point advantage right now. Oh, hey, cool, another one. So this is actually an ideal setup for me. As you can see, my Archons have used their flanking code to completely surround the other team from all sides, and now they're hopefully going to keep them distracted long enough for me to build hulls on all different sides, like small ones, so they can't possibly take down all of them.
His units are very confusing right now because my Archons, as you can see, they're running around in circles and don't know what they're doing.
Yeah, I am kind of crazy like that.
I got one Archon, I'm just saying. Killed one of them. His point advantage and the domination bar, as you can see, is because of the rounds, is decreasing. So now I'm in a lot of trouble. The only chance is if his Archons just magically die. But that's not happening.
That happens sometimes. Oh, there you go.
And now swimming submarines against you must construct additional pylons.
All right, I think my team is red. So our strategy is still the same, split up in two teams, try to see if this map is big enough. I think this map is big enough for us, so we will just build in the corners. Hopefully we can build three corners and get some tower build before the enemy comes so we can run away, because we're not going to beat them on fighting.
So my team is basically just going wherever they want, and hopefully they'll be able to see all of their corners at the same time and not lose on points.
You can see his units just came to one of the bottom right corner, and my team just teleport away and try to find a new corner to build some flux. I mean, convex hulls for points.
Yeah, their tower building code is a lot more efficient than mine. So if I don't continuously find them, then I'm probably going to lose on points.
Our guys are very afraid, though, so if they come near, even if maybe we could have won a fight, we will run away and kind of let them just crush our holes. So you can see that happening a little bit here.
My team kind of assumes it can't win any fights, but
Battle of the Fearful here.
Fear with fear. Oh, it looks like their team is coming and killing one of my holes. But my soldiers and chainers are kind of suicide units anyway, so they sometimes manage to get some kills.
Let's see.
Here comes suicide action. Oh, bottom left. There we go. Excellent. I guess against the team like theirs, it's not really a suicide, but they usually go in with the assumption it's a suicide because the main goal for the soldiers to go in is to stall the other team long enough for my Archons to escape, assuming it's a team that throws rock.
Comments? Pretty tight one here. I mean, one of the good things for him is like he gets to keep building up his hole because we keep running away and then you kill some of our hole and then we build some more and then you kill that, we run away more. He can keep building it in the center, so it's tight. We try to connect here, you'll see our two holes in the bottom. Never mind.
Hero
too
soldier.
Too slow.
Hero soldier.
Maybe we can get that line in the top left a little better shape would be nice.
All right. So hopefully he doesn't rebuild any of his holes. And then I think I have an advantage. If he magically decides to just freeze up and not do anything else.
Hey, you never know.
Oh, man.
Nice hole you got there. See if this is a large enough map for us to build or if we decide to fight. Oh man. Building, it looks like a little confused. It's not the corner, guys. That's what happens when you don't build in the corner. Come on, guys.
All right, so I've got a really tiny hole. So, not anymore.
So our guys will fight a tiny bit. I mean, it's a question of, I don't know how much his guys will fight, but we run away pretty quickly. If we have a really good advantage, we'll try to fight.
So as a side note, you might have noticed that my guys were building two kinds of buildings. This is because I didn't realize welts could build buildings until like 3 days before the deadline. So after I put in code to make welts build buildings, I wanted to see how much that affected my code. So I had them spawn a different kind of building so I could see easily. And then I didn't really change it when I submitted the code.
Knocking down our hole again, gosh. You guys need to show a little backbone here, come on.
So actually this player is kind of optimized to play against teleporting player. So that's probably why I send a lot of soldiers to random places. Oh.
Don't know what'll happen here. We're not really holding on to our territory much though against this player.
Now we have Boyd Boyd against Drunkosaurus.
Well, okay. Thanks.
Hi again.
Hey. Ooh, this map
have
is
we
bigger.
Played on this before? Hopefully not.
Well, for you guys, hopefully.
No,
The team numbers do not match who we actually are. Yeah, this is not us.
Luke's gonna like me.
Gravitas, can you come up?
Who else?
Experience. Yeah, so Gravitas, you should come up.
And as you can tell, I'm already getting my ass kicked, but yeah, it's kind of expected because Gravitas actually beat me to get into the finals. So, fun times.
Accidental bracket mishap. Sorry.
So, as you can see, I think Gravitas's main thing is to swarm against me and try to kill as many as possible before they build, and they're doing a pretty good job, or getting ready to, at least.
Yeah, so I think it looks like us. We have one Archon building in the middle, and the rest are just fighting and getting confused by the many Archons.
It's a nice square.
Yeah.
Pentagon.
It's a house now. Now it's a house. And
tent.
If they move to the other side, we might
tent
get
with
a cut.
Partial basement. Oh. Got a sale going on there a little bit.
So on top, we are chasing an Archon and trying to spawn soldiers so we can actually catch him.
So yeah, I'm really hoping that I'll accidentally take out one of their buildings for that hull. Oh, oh, all right.
So we got the Archon, but lost the hull.
Yeah, as you can see, they're already catching up to me really quickly and about to overtake me. Oh wait, never mind, I got it for a while at least.
So on the skirmish server, we actually played Drunkasaurus two times, or rather one match, and both of them we lost to him using both our strategies. And so we actually modify our strategy a little bit to try to better perform against strategies like his, which split up. So what
seems
we do is
worked.
Our Archons might actually split up to chase as well, so we don't get too caught up with just one Archon.
Yeah, at this point I think they've managed to gain a decisive advantage. Unless I can manage to take out most of their hull like they've done to mine, okay, that might work. Nope.
So here again, we will actually split up our Archons and they will act independently, which is just a nicer way to say that they will act randomly.
Pew, pew, pew.
Yeah, those sounds got annoying last year.
Well, I'm hoping they'll split up because I might actually have be able to beat them in one-on-one combat. But yeah, so or like all of mine versus their swarm, not so much. Oh, hey, I got one.
Got one of our Archons.
So for some reason, my guys aren't really building right. Oh, there they go. They have this thing where they like to, as soon as I say something, contradict me. My Archons are about to lose. Now they start being consistent. Yeah, I'm really hoping my guys will go over there and manage to notice that gigantic hull over on the west end of the map, but looks like they're pretty satisfied to sit around and, yep.
Okay.
So now we have Boyd against you must construct additional pylons. Yeah, and we greatly apologize for the bracket.
Best
the tournament software is actually correct. The bracket is wrong.
Yeah, I don't think you want to play the same person again.
Okay, so we're actually the red team this time.
Yeah, definitely.
And we open up the same way by swarming. And hopefully we'll decide that it's a large map this time. But that's kind of up to the Archons. We shouldn't have left it up to the Archons. Sometimes they're kind of stupid.
So right now we've detected that we've killed three Archons, so even if it's not a large map, we'll start building anyways. So hopefully that will... Hopefully we'll start getting a halt soon.
Hopefully that was enough of a distraction to keep the... Never mind. So with only two Archons left, there isn't really much hope. But we'll see.
So I'll be honest, I have not been this excited about triangles since eighth grade geometry. You really start to like them.
Steven was responsible for all of our triangle code. Sometimes they make kites, sometimes they make boxes too. Those are exciting.
We were wondering what kind of profane drawings we could make with the towers, but it turns out we decided to spend our time actually getting points instead. I'm sorry, it would have made for a better show. So this was the map that we lost horribly to Bellman Ford on. There are two cases where Archons will break off and explode. One of them is if there's a very large map and we detect this and we'll split off and then go to the corners and build. And the other is if we just actually explode.
So right now we're mostly wandering around, lost and confused. We chase after enemies if we see them, and otherwise we have some pretty bad search code, which goes to places where the enemy isn't.
So right now I'm hoping my Archons will be smart and actually run across voids, even though they're not specifically told to do so.
There we go. We've hit the magical three Archon kills, so we'll also start building now.
The enemy actually stays alive until all of their units, including buildings, are destroyed. And previously, they've actually stayed alive and won.
Now we have Bellman Ford against Black Sheep.
So we're the red team, we're Bowman Ford, and what we do is actually, our strategy is kind of, we try to take all sides of the rock, paper, scissors aspect. So first we start with rock in case they try to kill us with fighting. And then the server crashes.
We ran out of heap.
Alright. So anyway, we try to first fight them, in case they're a fighting team, but then if we see that they're building too many workers, we're gonna split off and try to build on our own, because we've lost in the past to teams that just run around and try to build everywhere, and we just spend the whole time trying to kill them. Anyway, something else is, when we detect that we kill Archons, we think, okay, great, we can take them on in a fight. So we send an Archon to the middle to be dedicated to just building. And that way, we find that our building is a lot